Paul had similar problems to what we have today. And he had this in the first century, in the Jewish culture that he found himself in. And I have no doubt that he faced his own form of, you don't need to talk to me about Christianity because I do this or that. Today we'll be looking at Philippians chapter 3, verse 1 to 11, although we'll mainly be focusing on verses 2 to 9. In these verses, Paul basically tells the Philippian believers to beware of the dangerous teachings of a religious group that were called the Judaizers. They believed that Jesus was truly the Messiah, but what made them a heretical group was their teaching that one is not saved by just simply trusting in Jesus, but all Christians are also required to fulfill some of the Jewish ceremonial customs. And the most notable of the customs that they needed to follow was circumcision. Paul considered this teaching to be opposed to the gospel, and he referred to this faith plus works righteousness in Galatians 1 verse 6. That's actually the context of Galatians, as he's dealing with these Judaizers. And in Galatians 1 verse 6, he refers to this gospel of faith plus works, faith plus Jewish ceremonial customs, as another gospel. It's not the true gospel, it's another gospel. There's a big difference between the true gospel that teaches that God saves us by trusting in Jesus alone, and this false gospel that teaches that we are saved by trusting in Jesus along with our good works. If you don't do this or that, you're not going to go to heaven. You can trust in Jesus, but that's not enough. Now, you also have to do this or that. This false gospel most likely arose in response to the conversion of the Gentiles to Christianity. In pre-New Testament Judaism, Gentiles became a part of God's covenant people or special people by becoming what was called a proselyte. It was a convert to Judaism. They were called a proselyte. This was technically how a Gentile could become a Jew. And you just have to think of Rahab or Ruth. Now, the proselytizing process was that the Gentile going through the process would receive what they called a proselyte baptism. And the men would be circumcised. In the early church, initially only Jews were becoming Christians. So everybody that got saved was circumcised. But soon after that, Samaritans and Gentiles were also becoming Christians. When any person got saved during this time, they were baptized. Now that made sense. Proselyte baptism. That could follow. So it may have seemed logical in the light of the proselytizing process that they should also be circumcised, these uncircumcised people. Now in Acts chapter 15, the apostles called the first church council in Jerusalem to discuss the topic and came to the conclusion that the Gentiles were under no obligation to adopt Jewish ceremonial customs. In fact, the book of Hebrews teaches that Jews were under no obligation either to continue with any of the other ceremonial Jewish customs. Now, obviously, some of the Judaizers rejected this judgment and continued to teach that when a Gentile is saved, he needs to be circumcised. And he is still under obligation to follow the Jewish customs. You can't eat any pork. It was about this group that Paul wrote in the church to the church in Galatia, warning them not to believe the false gospel that they were hearing. Just listen to how strongly Paul rebukes some of the Galatians for believing this false gospel in Galatians chapter 1, verse 6 to 8. He says, "I am astonished that you are so quickly deserting the one who called you by the grace of Christ and are turning to a different gospel, which is really no gospel at all." It's not good news at all. Evidently, some people are throwing you into confusion and are trying to pervert the gospel of Christ. But even if we or an angel from heaven should preach a gospel other than the one we preach to you, faith in Christ alone, let him be eternally condemned. With this background knowledge behind us, we can now come to today's text in Philippians chapter 3. Paul here warns the Philippian believers to beware of the Judaizers and their false gospel. In verse 2 of Philippians chapter 3, he calls them those dogs, those men who do evil, those mutilators of the flesh. He most likely called them dogs because the Jews used to call the Gentiles dogs. But Paul is saying that the real dogs are the Judaizers, not these Gentiles. He also called them mutilators of the flesh, most likely in response to their teaching on the obligation of every Christian to be circumcised. He then says that they have no right to be called the circumcision, but only those who have the Holy Spirit. Boast of Jesus as their Savior and have no confidence in their own works for salvation, can truly call themselves the circumcision. Paul then uses himself as an example to show what it truly means to place no confidence in your own goodness for salvation. He does this by pretty much writing in verses 4 to 6 that if anybody could boast of their religious achievements, it was him. And by writing that he counted all those religious achievements as rubbish in verses 7 to 9. Let's look at how Paul goes about showing what it means to place no confidence in the flesh under 2 points this evening. Let's look at the first point. Stop trusting in your own pedigree or works. In verses 4 to 6, Paul was basically saying to the Philippian believers that if any of them thought that they were amazing at obeying the Jewish law, he was way better than them. He does this by laying out his credentials in verses 5 and 6. He begins by saying that if anyone thought that they had more pedigree than him, they obviously didn't know about his family. Let's stick with this imagery of dogs. Paul was a pure breed. He was the champion. He was the pure breed from champion parents, while everybody else, in comparison to him, was just a pavement special. He begins by giving his credentials by saying that he was circumcised on the eighth day. Why is that significant? That's the earliest possible time anybody can be circumcised. You can't be circumcised one day earlier. In other words, he was considered a part of the covenant people of Israel as soon as was humanly possible. Then he continued by saying that he is an Israelite, a part of God's chosen nation. These credentials are pretty good, but he is one of many that could make such a boast. There were many Israelites around. Then he differentiated himself a little bit more by saying that he was from the tribe of Benjamin. Now, Benjamin had its problems, if you've seen in the book of Judges, but Benjamin was also a very special tribe. Just consider how Jacob loved Benjamin so much. Benjamin and Joseph, because they came from the most loved of all the wives. This was pretty impressive also when you consider that Israel's first king was from the tribe of Benjamin. That Benjamin, along with Judah, made up the southern kingdom of Israel. And why is that significant? Because they remained under the Davidic rule. They remained under the Davidic rule, while the other 10 tribes were led by men that were not from the line of David. He also says that Benjamin's also special because Benjamin was the only son of Jacob born in the promised land. And what about Mordecai, the deliverer of the Jews? Do you know what? He was a Benjamite. This is a good tribe to come from. Maybe it's not as impressive as the tribe of Judah, but it's a close second. This man came from an impressive family. He then stated that he was a Hebrew of Hebrews, meaning that he wasn't just any Jew, but the son of Hebrew parents. Now, as a result of the spread of Jews all over the Roman Empire at that time, and the fact that the commonly spoken language in the Roman Empire was Greek, many Jews only spoke Greek, and they couldn't speak Hebrew or Aramaic. These Jews were called Hellenistic Jews. But Paul wasn't one of those Hellenistic Jews. No, you need to understand that. He was almost like a purebred. His parents were seriously traditional Jews. The kind of parents that would have been wouldn't have been very happy if little Paulie brought a girl home that wasn't seriously committed to the Jewish faith. They might have even had a problem with a Hellenistic Jewish girl. She's not quite good enough. She doesn't come from the same cloth as us. This meant that Paul was just about as Jewish as you could get when it comes to his family tree. But Paul didn't stop there. He had the good works to match his family tree. Paul wasn't just your average member of Jewish society. Paul was a Pharisee. Now, nowadays, if you call someone a Pharisee, they might have a problem with that. They might think that you're calling them self-righteous. They're saying you're the kind of person that when you walk into a room, a dark room, it suddenly lights up from your purity and your good morals. That's the kind of image you get. That's what they're trying to say about you, that's what you think of yourself. Nobody today or back in Paul's days would wear such a title with honor. But in the first century, to be a Pharisee was a position of great honor in Jewish society. They were renowned as the holiest men in Jewish society who were passionate about obedience to the law. And if you ever read about the history of the Pharisees, they didn't start off badly. It goes all the way back to the Maccabean revolt, and they showed a lot of integrity and bravery, and they got to their position of power through great strength. And they stood up against a great foe. And that respect came from somewhere. And that was still in the minds of the people back then. We mustn't forget that. When you said you were a Pharisee, the people of Israel knew that you were passionate about obedience to the law. Paul said that in regard to the law, he was a Pharisee. Paul also stated that when it came to obeying the law, he was about the best you got. When he wrote, "As for legalistic righteousness, I was faultless." If Paul was self-righteous, could you blame him? Would you not be if you could honestly make such a claim to legalistic obedience? If you just quickly look at Romans 7 at some point, you get the idea that Paul obeyed the law so well that the only thing he could catch himself in was envy. Now that's significant, because you can find a way to say, "I've obeyed the Ten Commandments perfectly with all of the other 9 commandments," if you at least want to have a low standard, a low bar. But when it comes to envy, that's a sin of the heart. Then you have to go inside and you have to think to yourself, "Oof, I can't say I haven't envied somebody." And that's where Paul got caught. Very interesting. He even says that if you think my religion was cold, you better keep quiet. He wrote in verse 6 that he was so passionate about the Jewish religion that he worked tirelessly to persecute the church. He was such an effective persecutor of the church that he actually chased most of the Christians out of Jerusalem. You can see that in Acts chapter 8, verse 1 to 3. You don't achieve that kind of a success from something you're merely obligated to do. You need to be driven by passion. This is why in verse 6 he wrote, "As for zeal, he was persecuting the church." Paul had impressive credentials to show to God one day when he stood before him. If we were looking for someone in our South African context that could kind of fit this description, he would have to come from a family of famous preachers. Perhaps the great, great, great grandson of Charles Spurgeon. Oh, wait, this is South Africa, so Andrew Murray. He would have to be a 30-year-old man with 2 doctorates in theology, fluent in Greek, Hebrew, and Latin, familiar with all the Puritan works, and already have 3 children that behave perfectly. He would have to be a picture of immense discipline, getting up 4 a.m. every morning to pray for 2 hours, read through the Bible 4 times a year, preach 10 times a week, and still write countless books. This man would have to be a passionate enemy of bad doctrine, frivolous behavior, a tireless worker, and still be a family man at the same time. This is the kind of standard we are talking about here. It sounds unbelievable, but you need to understand that this is the kind of description that Paul was giving about himself. The Jewish people would have listened to this and gone, "Wow, this is serious." That isn't the most unbelievable thing about Paul, though. What is far more striking is that despite all of these amazing achievements in Judaism, he trusted in Jesus alone for his salvation. This leads us to our second point, which is trust in Jesus Christ alone. What Paul wrote next is one of the most beautiful and encouraging things a sinner like ourselves and many other sinners sitting here could ever hear. Just listen to this from verses 7 to 9. "But whatever was to my profit, I now consider loss for the sake of Christ. What is more, I consider everything a loss compared to the surpassing greatness of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord, for whose sake I have lost all things. I consider them rubbish that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but that which is through faith in Christ, the righteousness that comes from God and is by faith." Paul wrote that all those things that he always believed would make him righteous before God, he now considered them as rubbish. A word so strong that it could also be translated as dung or feces. Just look at your King James Version. Paul wasn't saying that being a Jew was a bad thing. But if being a Jew was going to stop him from having a relationship with Jesus, he would consider his ethnicity rubbish. Paul wasn't saying that participating in Jewish customs or circumcision was a bad thing. But he was saying if those things stopped you from having a relationship with Jesus, he considered them rubbish. While Paul was trusting in those things for his salvation, they were no longer good things. In fact, he described them as a loss. That's significant. They were a loss because he was trusting in these things for his salvation. While he was trusting in these things for his salvation, they were no longer helpful towards him. They were not even neutral. They were, in fact, negative. Trusting in anything other than Jesus Christ for your salvation is not a neutral action on your part. It is a sin. That includes helping an old lady cross the road and sitting there saying, "This is going to get me to heaven." That's a sin. Please do it still, but it's a sin. It's an act of absolute rebellion that can be thought of as someone waving their fist in God's face and saying, "You will not receive all the glory for my salvation. I did a lot to secure my own salvation as well. You don't take all the credit. I deserve a little bit of credit here too." When Paul was converted on the road to Damascus, he realized something, that all of his efforts to earn salvation were only condemning him more. So in that moment, he stopped trying to earn his own salvation, and he trusted in Jesus alone. That's why he so passionately fought the false gospel being taught by the Judaizers. Because he knew that only those who trust in Jesus alone for their salvation will ever have a relationship with Jesus. A gospel that teaches Jesus plus works is a false gospel. In fact, it is no gospel at all. John Wesley, before he was saved, was a part of a group called the Holy Club, along with his brother Charles Wesley and a close friend, George Whitfield. Some of you might know who he is. This group of men were renowned for their study of the scriptures, their seriousness about the Christian faith, their social outreach, and moral lives. But none of these three men were Christians at this point. None of them were Christians. Each got saved and continued to study the scriptures, continued to be serious about the faith, continued social outreach, and continued to live moral lives. So, their behavior didn't really change. Pre-salvation, post-salvation. The difference between them before salvation and after salvation was that before salvation, they were trusting in those things to save them. Well, after salvation, they didn't trust in those things at all, but rather continued to do them simply because they loved Jesus. In fact, they did them with greater zeal because love will always outwork obligation. I'm not saying that to attend church, get baptized, to live a holy life, to read all of John Calvin's commentaries, to read your Bible daily, or pray a lot is bad. But if you are trusting in these things to save you, they're actually condemning you. A Christian is meant to study God's word, serve his neighbor, and pray without ceasing as a result of a heart that overflows with gratitude for God saving him already. It's happened in the past. If you have an attitude about the Christian faith that says, "Jesus died for me, but I'll only go to heaven if I actually keep trying to live a way that pleases him." I understand. We don't want to fall into the trap of antinomianism, which is basically like, "Oh, you know what? You know, we're all going to go to heaven if I just put my faith in Jesus and then I live like this lawless gangster, I'm going to be okay." I understand we want to guard against that. But don't fall on the other side either. We could very easily start to "Oh, I sinned. Oh, no, now I have to go and, you know, now I have to go to church twice as much." Oh, that's legalism. That's legalism too. Thinking that we can earn credit back with God. The answer is not to earn credit back with God. You can't earn credit back. It's to fall at the foot of the cross and say, "Forgive me, I'm sorry. Thank you for saving me. I'm a terrible person. Please empower me to live a holy life." The true gospel is, "For it is by grace that you have been saved through faith, and this is not from yourselves. It is a gift from God, not by works, so that no one can boast." And after that, it says it will produce good works. So it will produce good works, but those good works don't save you. We are saved by trusting in Jesus alone. Good works only come when God has saved you and given you his Spirit. If you are guilty of trusting in your own good works, your family tree, your zeal for the church, please hear me. you are sinning. All those things are sin if they're done with the wrong motive. Paul counted all of his religious achievements as absolute dirt for an opportunity to know Jesus. And he wasn't disappointed. Knowing Jesus as his Lord and Savior gave him far more joy than feeling that he was a superior Jew to everybody else. Let me close with this. Don't allow your pride to hold you back from an eternally joy-giving relationship with Jesus Christ, the living God. All you need to do is stop trusting in anything else, to cling to the foot of the cross and beg Jesus to forgive you and to help you on a daily basis to live in a way that's pleasing to him. Not because it will save you, but because he has already saved you. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for how Paul presented the gospel to us here. We thank you that you gave Paul such an exemplary life, at least by the standards of Judaism. We thank you that you gave him this life and you gave him this pedigree so that he could throw it all away and show us that the only solution to our problem is trusting in you alone. If Paul was willing to throw it all away for you, whatever we have, we should throw away with a lot more ease. We thank you for the sermon, Lord, from Paul in the book of Philippians. We pray, Lord, that you may speak to us through his life, through his actions, and through his faith. And please, Lord, may you guard our hearts, because even as believers sometimes we fall into the trap, Lord, of trying to earn some credit back when we've sinned. Lord, please guard our hearts from that legalistic tendency and help us to turn to you instead. And Lord, we also pray in this moment for anyone that may be sitting here this evening that does not know you as their Lord and Savior. Perhaps someone sitting in this church today that is a moral person. In fact, is quite impressive, but does not actually have a relationship with you. Is doing these things because they think it's earning them credit, that it's getting them to heaven quicker. Please, Lord, would you work in their hearts? Would you use the example of Paul to point them to you and show them what true salvation really is? Amen.